Let us recite Surah Al-Fatiha for those of us in our families who have left this world. I particularly remember a brother who was present a year and a half ago in this congregation who is no longer with us. He has passed away, a young, beautiful brother from this community. And his name is Ali. Let us recite Fatiha for his blessed soul as well as all those who have passed away. Surah Al-Fatiha. Bismillah min ash-shaytan al-ayn al-rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وخاتم النبيين أبي القاسم محمد. وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المأسومين المظلومين. أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه المجيد وقوله الحق وهو أصدق الصادقين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسوله واتقوا الله إن الله سميع عليم صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوات على محمد وآل محمد I begin in the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is most worthy of praise for having given us imams and prophets to protect the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has given us good examples as role models by which to follow so that our actions can be perfected towards that which brings us perfect harmony. When we function optimally, which is to bow to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through good actions, and when we follow the right path after having engaged intellectually in the right direction, we will be the recipients of eternal bliss in this world as well as in the next. Bliss and happiness is a relative term, meaning somebody who goes out and murders people and steals money from them and cheats them could also have a false sense of perception that they are happy, meaning that they feel satisfied killing people. That form of happiness is a relative form of happiness. It is not really the true form of happiness. It is what we call short-lived happiness. It is the kind of happiness which is actually destructive. Ultimately, it causes one's own destruction. But during the moment that they are committing the evil or the crime act, they feel good about it. It is a good analogy to use is like somebody who indulges in hallucinogenic drugs. Drugs which give you what they call a high. You'll find when they take it for the moment, they feel good about it. But the ultimate result of taking such hallucinogenic, what they call barbiturates and so on, is it's counterproductive and destructive. It actually kills you and causes others to die in the process. But people do it only to receive this short sense of feeling of happiness. They don't care about the long-term damages, rather they just care about the short-term happiness as a means to escape their perceived or their real problems in life. Allah is so merciful that He has given us so much intelligence, incredible amount of intelligence, and the power of this intelligence speaks for itself. When we have these discussions on this platform, there are emotions, there are people who have opinions, there are ideas, there are backgrounds, There are experiences, lifetime experiences that we bring with us, even in this forum, where we test out the waters and the discussions on whether or not this element of discussion, does it really make sense? Is it sensible? Is it logical? While I'm assessing my whole history, my past, everything comes with me. Simultaneously, I'm assessing my future and figuring out whether it is worth for me to sit in this kind of a gathering, for example. This is a very subtle form, as we call it, but it's a very intricate and sophisticated form of intelligence. You've seen that when we came here, most of us came in some vehicle, a car. It is incredible to imagine that all you need to do is press a pedal and the entire engine is activated forward, backward, however you want to go. Just think about that. You sit comfortably on a seat and you just press a pedal and the entire thing takes you somewhere. And you move at such incredible speeds, it was unheard of in the previous generations that a person could actually move at such speeds. And we move at such speeds that once our windows are shut down, shut out, in other words, shut completely, you feel like nothing of the outside. The noise level is so low, like you're sitting in your living room, when in fact you're moving fast and vast distances all in one shot. That's an intelligent being who's able to put this together. And he's made it so generic that anybody in the world, whether he speaks Spanish or English, can turn an engine on and press the pedal. Isn't that incredible? That the buttons that are on the dashboard are so universally made that you generally know where the air conditioner is and where the fan is and where the defogger is, because there are so many universal symbols there. This is an ingenious being who's able to make this and mass produce them in such a fashion that millions of cars can come out in a day, for example. Take it even to a higher scale, those of us who've flown and come into Australia, for example, you sit in a jumbo 747 and it takes off like it's nothing, you know, one giant bird, big bird, just taking off, carrying 350, 400 passengers moving, like you're sitting in a living room, watching a movie. They serve you like you're sitting in your living room when you're in fact crossing thousands of miles across the ocean. That's an ingenious being. That there are millions and millions of wires going through this capsule that you're in, that pressure controls and temperature controls, and the pilot knows exactly. It's amazing when he's arriving at that airport, I always wonder, I said, SubhanAllah, up there, how did he know where to go? How did he know where to reach? How did he know right at that target that when that aircraft is touching that ground, he's got it right away, because a few hundred yards before there's water and he brings it right in, a gigantic monstrous bird with hundreds of passengers and lives, you know, carefree, they just land and glide. I said, SubhanAllah, this is the ingenuity Allah has given mankind. This is what we have. We need to take this, utilize it, appreciate it, and constantly submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that yes, indeed, indeed, you are the one who gave me this power. Indeed, while I was flying up there, if not for that air up there, you know, even a 747 is actually gliding on air. It's gliding on air. If there is an air pocket, that gigantic monstrous bird, according to you and I, will drop like a rock. As fast as it's moving, its wings will do nothing for us. The reason is, it's the wind that's keeping it. Allah says, أَوَلَمْ يَرَوْا إِلَى الطَّيْرِ فَوْقَهُمْ صَافَّاتٍ وَيَقْبِذًا مَا يُمْسِكُهُنَّ إِلَّا الرَّحْمَنِ إِنَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ بَصِيرٌ. Do you not see the bird with its wings open, flying? Allah says, who keeps it up there? It is the Almighty Lord, Allah, who keeps it. You don't see it. إِنَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ بَصِيرٌ. He is all-seeing. That when I sit in this aircraft, as arrogant as I can be, you see some of the people sitting there in first class, sipping their wine, thinking they're God's given gift to mankind? Those who have an attitude problem, not generally people who sit in first class have that attitude, but imagine somebody with an attitude, having an arrogant feeling like he's superior to other human beings. And if that wind stops holding this aircraft, this haughty creature suddenly starts crying and says, oh my God, right? Starts begging to hold on to his life. Allah says, وَإِذَا غَشِيَهُمْ مَوْجٌ كَالظُّلَلِ دَعْوَ اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ فَلَمَّا نَجَّاهُمْ إِلَى الْبَرِّ فَمِنْهُمْ مُقْتَصِدٌ وَمَا يَجْهَدُ بِآيَاتِنَا إِلَّا كُلُّ خَتَّارٍ كَفُورٍ. Allah says, when the waves cover this person, وَإِذَا غَشِيَهُمْ مَوْجٌ كَالظُّلَلِ, puts him into darkness, he makes da'wa Allah, he seeks to God. Oh God, please help me, please, I'll do anything for you. مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ, Allah says. He's so sincere, مُخْلِصِينَ, because he's on the edge of his life now. See, all the time when he's alive, he's healthy, he says, what God? I don't need a God. Who are you talking? You're wasting your time about God and religion and bowing down. I say, when this pain starts dropping, you'll begin to know what it really means. Belief in your pride that nothing in this aircraft is going to hold you up. Nothing except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And should you die in this aircraft, not a problem. Because when you've given allegiance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you say, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, it makes no difference. For it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who in His infinite mercy will give you your compensation, whether you die in an aircraft or you die on the battlefield. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. And always when you look out in the horizon, you see how Allah has made it so beautiful that this aircraft can go through clouds. Clouds, it's not like some cotton fabric, you know, where the plane gets jammed in it. You know, in that the clouds are going through the engine, you make it like, is it going to clog up the engine? But it's just, you know, it's a dense form of air. Subhanallah, something Allah has allowed to exist, which moves water from one direction to another. How brilliant. Subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing us. He said, look, these are the simple matters. إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمِ يَعْقِلُونَ لِقَوْمِ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. These are signs for people who think, who know. Allah said, قُلْ أَرَأَيْتُمْ إِنْ أَصْبَحَ مَاءُكُمْ غَوْرًا فَمَنْ يَأْتِكُمْ بِمَاءٍ مَّعِينٍ. If these clouds don't gather in the air and bring you this water, torrential rain, who will make your rivers flow? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking in Suratul Mulk, أَرَأَيْتُ مِنْ أَصْبَحَ مَاءَكُمْ غَوْرًا فَمَنْ يَأْتِيكُمْ. Who? In Australia, I know when I was here the last time and until now, you go through these frequent droughts, periods where there is a shortage of water. All our technology in the world will do nothing but to submit to the Almighty Lord, begging Him through this Salatul Istisqa, you see, to try to bring rain, the prayer of rain. There's a prayer Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given mankind and taught it to us through the messenger and the imams on how to pray, that should you have a drought, once that prayer is accepted, the torrential rain starts coming for you. For rain and water is such an important part of my existence that if it doesn't come and the drought is truly a drought where there is total arid land, we will all start to drop dead. That's how important it is. Our technology, our machinery, our electricity, all will stop functioning if this rain doesn't come down at its appointed time. Yet when this aircraft is going through it, I said the same element that is carrying my water, that is carrying my sustenance, is allowing me to pass through it. That while you don't even see through this cloud, and it gives you a very fuzzy feeling, like you're hoping there's no plane in front of you, yet Allah has given us the power to send out sound waves and sonars and radars to be able to see in the front without even seeing it through the visual cortex, subhanAllah. This is the power Allah has given us. I'm bringing some basic elemental facts which all of us know about, but many of us take it for granted, thinking that it's there, just hop on a plane and go. But little do we realize that there are so many facets of physics alone where this aircraft is following, and it is rigidly following, that if it flips or fails in one aspect of it, this entire aircraft can fall right into the ocean or on the land. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful that He's bringing thousands and thousands of people. When I stand at the airport, I look at all these people coming out and all the families meeting them. I said, how appreciative are we that that family that you're going to meet right now has been brought safely? It is when disaster strikes, when you hear the phone call that plane has crashed, you begin to realize the value of all the good flights that we've had. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to understand this. This is the crux of submission to Allah. The one, Allah says, وَمَا يَجْهَدُ بِآيَاتِنَا. Allah says, when this wave covers them, they become arrogant, you know, they start asking Allah sincerely. وَإِذَا غَشِيَ مَوْجٌ كَالظُّلَلِي دَعُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ فَلَمَّا نَجَّاهُمْ إِلَى الْبَرِّ. When we bring them to the shore, فَمِنْهُمْ مُقْتَصِدْ. They take the middle course. Oh, really? There's God? Where? Really? Ah, I don't know. I'm not sure. Really? Ah, well, I don't really have time for it. Yeah. فَمِنْهُمْ مُقْتَصِدْ. وَمَا يَجْهَدُ. Allah says, بِآيَاتِنَا. No one rejects the signs of Allah. إِلَّا. Except. كُلُّ. All. خَتَّارٍ كَفُورٍ. The perfidious rejector. May Allah give us the strength to always fight this perfidy and never to be among those of the kuffar to say, ah, all of this is just a chance. On that note, I say to you, my respected sisters and brothers in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gifted us with messengers. The last messenger, Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, comes from a pure tree, Shajaratin Mubarak, the best tree, which I mentioned before from Surah An-Nur, La Sharqiyatin wa la Gharbiya, neither east nor west, a special tree. This is our messenger. He is the chosen one. He is the one who the universe was created for. Now, here's a bombshell for some of us. But that's a name. The universe was created for the messenger? What is this? In Hadith al-Kisa, Jibreel is saying to the messenger, this ayat at-Tahir, which was revealed about Ahlul Bayt, when the messenger with Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, with Bibi Fatima alayhi salam, Imam Hassan alayhi salam, and Imam Hussein alayhi salam, were in this mantle, the famous event of Kisa, which is the green mantle, you find Jibreel is commanded by Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to Jibreel, he gives him this ayah, إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ. What you find is the messenger, when he's in this mantle, he takes the corners, he looks up in the sky, he says, إِنَّ هَؤُلَاءِ أَهْلَ بَيْتِ. This is my Ahlul Bayt. O Allah, purify them with a thorough purification. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals this ayah, إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ. What you find is when Jibreel comes down and he gives this ayah to the messenger, before he does this, he says, Inni, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, azza wa jal, yuqriuka as-salam, right? Wa yakhussuka bit-tahiyyati wal-ikram, wa yaqulu laka, Inni ma khalaqtu sama'an mabniya, wala ardan madhiya, wala qamaran muniran, wala shamsan mudiya, wala falakan yadur, wala bahrin yajri, wala fulkan yasri, إلا في محبة هؤلاء الخمسة الذين هم تحت الكساء. What is beautiful is even Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal says that if you don't love these five of Ahlul Bayt, you are outside the fold of Islam. Everybody acknowledges this. The importance of these five members, why did Allah create it for them? What it means in the simplest of ways without taking too much time is Allah created the universe bilhaq. خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ بِالْحَقِّ, Allah says in the Quran. He created the universe, the earth and the sky in truth, bilhaq. The true embodiment of haq in its purest sense of the word, in actions as ashraful makhluqat, meaning the best of creation, which is mankind. Hence, Iblis and all the malaika had to bow to Adam. It was this Allah showing that this is my best creation. Ashraf, the best, the superior makhluqat among all his creations. Why? Because our messenger represents that ultimate truth, haq, deen al-haq. What is deen al-haq? True submission to Allah. When Allah created aql first, he says, go, Aql went. He says, Aql come, Aql obey. Allah says, I love you. Among his creations, the nur of our messenger was already there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, who will worship me? And the nur says, ana, I. Meaning total submission, 100% submission. That is what is called the truest form of haqq. It's a deep statement I just made. Inshallah, I'll exemplify it in time. But you will see that a believer, when he does good deeds, he does it fi sabilillah. One might say, but it's a good deed. Why does God have to come into this good deed? Can't I just help the poor without ever mentioning God? No. If you do that without mentioning Allah, you are negating the very purpose you were created for. It is like saying, I will do a part of it, but I will reject the real cause of it. It's like giving a medal to somebody who does not deserve it, but you are giving the medal, when in fact the hero is someone else. You might say, but what's the difference? I gave a medal, whether I gave it to you or I gave it to him. After all, I gave the medal. You'll say, no, you give the medal to who deserves the medal, otherwise do not give it. Meaning the act of giving or the act of doing good, if it is not coupled with the truth of your own reality as to why you were created and what your intentions are on this earth for, it is negating the very essence of the act. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So our duty is to look at them because they are the ultimate truth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I created this universe in truth. If the embodiment that exemplifies truth in this trial system does not exist, then the existence of this universe is nullified. Meaning there is no need for the universe to exist. If the example that is going to fulfill the obligations by which Allah has laid us under, which is inni, to create, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah did not create jinn wal-ins, meaning the jinn who are creatures made of fire, and ins who are the creation made of clay. He did not create them, illa liya'budun, meaning except to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The worshipping of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most fundamental aspect of all discussions. And inshallah, I will explain further in time why submission to Allah and the belief in the system of the true religion is fundamental to goodness for all of humanity. One might say, but isn't it something like you go on Friday and do your Jummah prayers and then maybe you do salawat sometimes, or you do your salah, but it's not a big deal. It doesn't have any effect on humanity. Not at all. In fact, everything we talk about humanity hinges on submission to Allah, because the only way to guarantee the sanctity of our social relations in this world and in the hereafter is through submission to Allah and nothing else. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gifted us with his messengers and the representatives, Ahlul Bayt, because they are the ones who will become our guiding lights. It's very important to know that. Members of Ahlul Bayt are so important in Islam. Let me throw some light to it. People might say this Ahlul Bayt issue that, brother, you've been discussing the few nights is maybe an issue between Sunni and Shia, or maybe a group of one group versus another. No, it's not. It's much more than that. It's to do with the fundamental principles of Islam. Like I said, Hadith Kisa, Inni ma khalaqtu. We didn't create it, illa fi mahabbati, except for the love of this five. Meaning for you and I to attach on to this Hablil Wareed. You know, Hablil Wareed, of course, is this. Wa'tasimu bihablillahi jami'an. Hold on to the rope. What you find is that this is actually hinging on the love of Ahlul Bayt. The love of Ahlul Bayt takes us to the truth. Otherwise, it negates everything. Let me show you an example. In Surah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where he speaks about Mubahila, you know, the 10th year, some say the 11th year after Hijrah, the messenger was about to leave this world. You find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals a series of verses with regards to our perceptions and beliefs on how to tackle our Christian brethren, and particularly the idea of oneness of Allah versus the Trinitarian principle of the Christian brethren. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands our messenger to invite these Christians, قُلْ يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ تَعَالَوْ, come, let us have a dialogue and let us talk equitably on an equitable term and come on the same platform and discuss that we should worship none other than one God. During that period of time, the strength of the Christians in that part of the Arabia was in Najran. Najran was where the heart of the Christians was, because you notice Abraha, his predecessor, who actually originated from that part of the world, took elephants hoping to demolish the Kaaba. This was known as the year of the elephant, the year when our messenger was born, 570 AD. What you find is that Abraha tried to demolish the Kaaba because he wanted the central place of worship to be Najran and not Mecca. He found it competing, so he wanted to demolish it. And of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demolished him with birds, right? In Surah Al-Quraysh. أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ. Do you not see what we did to the people of the elephant? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, تَيْرَنَ أَبَابِيلَ. They were birds carrying little baked stones, and they dropped it on these people, and they were all destroyed, and the Kaaba remained intact. Who was the guardian of the Kaaba at that time? The grandfather of our messenger, Hazrat Abdul Muttalib. The pure generation of Banu Hashim, that tree, that blessed tree that never worshipped an idol. Hazrat Abu Talib, Hazrat Abdul Muttalib, none of these people were idol worshippers. They were true Hanifan Musliman. Once again, we are victims of history in trying to pull them into idolatry when they had nothing to do with idolatry. These were true worshippers of Allah who were silent. And the reason they were silent and they did not come forward promoting the Islam the way it was because their grandson, Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was commissioned to do that. They were his helpers. What you find is that the Prophet is inviting the peoples of Najran much later now, come. So 60 delegates come, Abdul Masih, Harith. These are all major personalities in Christendom in Najran who come, and they come and visit the messenger in Medina. When was this? This was around the 10th year after Hijrah, close to 11th year after Hijrah. They came to meet the messenger at the invitation of the messenger, and they had a discussion about the belief system, particularly about oneness of Allah. The whole confrontation between the Christians and the Muslims was with regards to the unity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning, this idea of Jesus being the Son of God, according to the Islamic principles, is not acceptable because Jesus never claimed to be the Son of God. Never. From the Islamic perspective, Isa alayhi salam is just a prophet of God, a great prophet of God, but certainly not divine as suggested. When they came to meet our messenger, they say, the messenger is asking them, why do you say this? They said, Isa had no son, no father, therefore he has to be the son of God. Allah replies, Inna mathali Isa inda Allahi ka mathali Adam. The similitude of Jesus is like Adam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him. ثُمَّ قَالَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. He said to them, be, and they became. Allah created them. So if Isa alayhi salam should be the son of God because he has no father, then the Quran was challenging that Adam should be a greater son of God because he has neither a mother nor a father. At least Jesus had a mother. So the Christians start getting into a dialogue, and subhanAllah, we should have the opportunity to read these ayahs in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exemplifies the whole event of how Christianity came about, what happens, and how the Quran refutes them. The whole ayah, the whole series of verses, inshallah, I'll display those to you next time. What you find is, they refuse after listening to all this. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, nad'u أبناءنا وأبناءكم ونساءنا ونساءكم وأنفسنا وأنفسكم. Subhanallah. Allah says, tell them, we will bring our sons, you bring your sons. We will bring our women, you bring your women. We will bring ourselves, you bring yourselves. And then we will invoke the curse of Allah on the liars. Now, observe the mastery of the Quran, my brothers and sisters. What's the argument about? Oneness of Allah. Who is the representative of Allah? Muhammad ibn Abdullah, the great messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What you find is, well, should Allah not just say that, look, get Abdul Masih or Harith, you know, the bishop, bring him. You and I can stand in front of the desert and we can stare at each other and we can put our hands up in the sky and we'll invoke the curse on each other. How's that? No. Abna'ana wa abna'akum wa nisa'ana wa nisa'akum. Why is the Quran asking the messenger to bring his sons, his women, and his self? Why? Why not just bring himself? After all, the discussion is to do with Christianity. In particular, the issue is Tawheed. Isn't Tawheed the center of Islam? Is it not the center of all discussions? That the oneness of Allah is what every messenger came to fight for? Didn't Ibrahim fight Nimrud for the oneness of Allah? Didn't Isa fight the Romans of that time for the oneness of Allah? Didn't Musa alayhi salam fight everybody for the oneness of Allah? Every prophet who fought his society, his ultimate message was Tawheed, Tawheed, Tawheed. Isn't it all? Ask anybody in the world, tell yes. Well, so if Tawheed is the issue, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing us that at the core of Tawheed, when this religion becomes completed, the core that will maintain the sanity and the sanctity of Tawheed is a family, not an individual. That is why Allah is commanding the messenger, tell these Christians to bring their sons and we will bring our sons. They'll then bring their women. Women? Why are you bringing women into this? What do women have to do with this debate? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing, إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ. أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ is unique. There is somebody special that Allah has chosen. إِنِّي مَا خَلَقْتُ سَمَاءً مَبْنِيَّ. This, we didn't create this, but for these. Who are these representatives? Why are they important? You will see that as you look at them from the Holy Quran, you begin to see that these personalities played a pivotal role in the establishment and in the protection of Islam until today. Hence, Allah has made it obligatory upon us to look at the members of Ahlul Bayt, and their love is so fundamental in Islam that to disconnect from it is tantamount to disconnecting from Tawheed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows that the challenges to the Christians, you find even in the Sahih of Muslim, you find he clearly mentions, he said, our messenger comes the following day because the Christians needed a day to think about it. And the following day they came, but before they came, they had a conversation with each other. And they said, if this man who's claiming to be the messenger of God comes with his companions, he is a liar. If he comes with his near family, back off. This was their statement. They say the following morning, the messenger had Imam Hussein in his arm. And on his left side was Imam Hassan in his arm, holding him, because Imam Hassan could walk. Imam Hussein was rather young. Behind him was Bibi Fatima alayhi salam. And behind her was Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. Now, the Christians looked at this, and they said, we saw light emanating from the faces of these five. And we knew that if we proceeded with this test of Mubahila, this challenge, we will all be destroyed. All 60 of us and all the members in Najran will be destroyed because of this curse upon us. So we will back off. So what was the point they made? They had already in their scriptures that first and foremost, that the true messenger shall have his core family with him, because that is the indication that we've been told that there is a special, exclusive family who has been chosen to be the sealer of this message. That even our Christian brethren admitted to that fact in history, that even in the Sahih of Muslim and in the historical books, it is clearly mentioned that Mubahila took place around the 11th or the 10th year after Hijrah. The news here is that our messenger was already married to his other wives, meaning all the other wives were in Medina. The ayah says, Nisa'ana wa nisa'akum. Nisa'ana in this verse is plural, not singular, not dual, plural, many. Our women, not our woman, our women. You find the only person who was behind the messenger was Bibi Fatima alayhi salam. Why not all the rest of the women? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing us, and our messenger, when the Christians backed off, right before they backed off, the Prophet looks up into the sky, he says, oh Allah, bear witness, these are my Ahlul Bayt. Inna ha'ulai Ahlul Bayti. These are my Ahlul Bayt. And you find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevates this Ahlul Bayt through a woman, Bibi Fatima alayhi salam, that when Jibreel comes, he says, Hum Fatimatu wa abuha wa ba'aluha wa banuha. Salawat ala Muhammadin wa ala Muhammadin. These personalities are so important that even the debate between the Christians and the Muslims with the issue of Tawheed, you find that the issue of Ahlul Bayt plays a role. It's not a matter of history later about Karbala and about the differences in the different schools of thought that we need to present Ahlul Bayt. No, even the existence of the universe, even the challenge among those who believe other than the Tawheed, you'll find that the peg by which Islam functions around from the Quranic perspective, it is Ahlul Bayt and none other. Thus, when we commemorate the Shahada of Imam Hussein, it is not an ordinary commemoration. It is not just a family being butchered. It is not just a story to incite people to cry. No, it is the very crux of my own existence that is being shattered and being challenged. That the blessed Imam is standing firm, for it is because of him Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put this whole universe in motion. Some people might say, is this not shirk and bid'ah? No, it is not. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses a pathway and a means by which we must understand the best means, who is going to challenge the Quran? Who can come forward and say that the Quran has made a mistake? Astaghfirullah. Only those who do not know the Holy Quran. The Holy Quran is a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When it speaks with perfection. When it uses its terminologies, it is so perfect that humans are baffled as to how accurate it is in its presentations. We are gifted by that. So let us all at least come to the terms with our discussion tonight that all these discussions that we are bringing forth is hinging around the stability and the importance of the love of Ahlul Bayt. That is very fundamental in our discussions. That from the Quranic perspective, the love of Ahlul Bayt, from every verse in the Quran, where you find وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا سُرَةُ الدَّهْرِ, you'll find every ayah, every surah that is referring to the chosen people of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is actually addressing them. It's either Bibi Fatima alayhi salam, إِنَّا عَتَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرِ, that we have given you kawthar, because people came to our messenger and said, ah, you have no son. You have a daughter. Allah says, we have given you kawthar. Some people translate kawthar as paradise. Our messenger did not live in this world so that Allah should appease him with telling him, don't worry, you got a big paradise waiting for you. Our messenger was high above that. He does not worship paradise. He does not worship Allah for the sake of paradise. Our messenger was an obedient servant who did not submit to Allah because he wanted paradise. Nor did he obey Allah because he was afraid of hell. He obeyed Allah, as Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam mentions, because Allah is worthy of submission to. That takes me on to the next level. That a believer, after he understands his obligations in Usul al-Din, the Tawheed, Adalat, Nubuwa, Imama, the final facet is Qiyama. When we talk about fear of my own punishment and my own misdeeds on the Day of Judgment. This completes the entire equation beautifully. Man amana billahi wal yawm al-akhir wa amila salih. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, من آمن بالله يا أيها الذين آمنوا والذين هادوا والنصارى والصابئين. All those of you believe, and the Jews, and the Christians, and the Sabians. Sabians are people who also are an offshoot of the Zoroastrian faith. والصابئين. من آمن بالله. Provided you believe in Allah. واليوم الآخر. And the Day of Judgment. بالله واليوم الآخر. بالله واليوم الآخر. You find Quran is constantly speaking about these two aspects. Because when you believe in Allah and are fearful of the Day of Judgment, you become a complete person. You have put yourself with the right focus, why you are here, what you are doing, where you are going, and why you were created to where you are going. Once you fulfill that obligation, you submit to the truth, you'll find the inner soul becomes tranquil and our destiny is taken control of. And Allah wishes that all of us should reach that stage. Man amana billahi wal yawmal akhir. Okay? Wa amila salih. Meaning, you must perform good deeds. Good deeds hinge on the idea and the reality of belief in Allah. I mentioned this before yesterday. I'll continue to exemplify this. And what does it mean about the Mother Teresa's in the world and those who do good, the good humanists and so on? Inshallah, I'll exemplify it in subsequent moments, in subsequent time, should time permit me. But the idea here is very clear, that the belief system is hinging on my submission to Allah first. When I submit, my good deeds, fi sabilillah, become valuable. They become alive. It's now I've plugged it in the right outlet. See, we can plug it in different outlets, but that doesn't mean the juice is going to come out. You have to plug it in the right outlet, and you have to find this outlet using this brilliant intelligence Allah has given us. And no one can deny that we lack this intelligence, because we have enough intelligence to be able to make all these fantastic systems around us. Thus, we all have been gifted. Most of humanity, except those who are mentally deficient, and that even then is a trial for those. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a sign to show how intelligent a being is by showing us those who lack it a little bit sometimes. But I don't want to get into that. I just wanted to suffice for us to say that I am going towards my Lord based on what He has given me. So, Qiyamah is fundamental. Why is Qiyamah fundamental? You will find that if you and I live in a society today where we know there is no police system, where there is no accountability to my actions, I will become a wretched creature. Now, does it mean everybody is going to become a wretched creature? No. Majority will become wretched creatures. There's always exceptions to the rule, meaning there will be some who will always be good even if there's no government. And that some who will always be bad, even if there is a government. We're not talking about exceptions to the rule. Social rules are never derived from exceptions. They're always derived from generalities. So as a general rule, if a country and a government does not have a police system, a judicial system, a means by which to control the actions of its citizens, that society will become what we call a wild, uncivilized, barbaric society. They will start killing each other, because that's just the law of humanity. Therefore, when we are subjected to knowing that there is a watchdog, should I misbehave, you will find the human being suddenly, naturally becomes curtailed. You find even a child who's outside hanging out on the streets, peddling drugs and creating disharmony, the day he's arrested and brought in front of the judge, look at that kid. I had that opportunity once. I was in court standing and I was watching this kid who was known to be a very recalcitrant child, a child who liked to disobey everybody, a tough guy. You could see it on his face. He was full of rage and ready to kill anybody. You could see it. You couldn't even stand in front of him because you're afraid he might punch you. And you find he came in front of the judge and I watched him for a good 10 minutes talking to the judge. And the judge looked at him and says, do you know what has happened to you? And you should have seen, you look like a, you know, soft little poodle. Yes, Your Honor. Yes, Your Honor. Of course, Your Honor. Yes, Your Honor. And I'm saying, but this guy doesn't have it in him. This is not him. Why is he doing this? Because he has come to terms that his destiny is on the line now. And he wants to escape this. So he's going to put on the right act. Isn't it interesting? He may not have any ounce of goodness in him with regards to being a good kid, but he already knows in his heart how to be good to get away from the judge too. Because his mind has been already trained on how to follow the truth and how to reject the truth. He knows it, but there's some anger that's driving him and ignorance that's causing him to be as wicked as he is. But he's come to terms. I said, Subhanallah. When I saw that moment, I remembered Yawm al-Qiyamah. That here's a judge, what can he do to this person? The most he can do is kill him. What then? Nothing. Nothing you can do. But what about then, where you can't die, but you are in the mercy of Allah forever? Hum fiha khalidun. Ulaika ashabun nar. These are the inmates of fire who shall live in it. When? Abqa. Forever, the ayah Quran says in other verses. What does it mean? No escape. Nothing. You find the individual becomes an entirely different creature once he knows that his actions are accounted for. So it's very important for us to have a clear perspective of Qiyamah. Yawmul Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even Surah Al-Baqarah in the beginning, He says, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِي هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. In the end, Allah says, وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوقِنُونَ. And of the day of judgment, they are certain. We, many of us, violate the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We reject salah, for example. We don't pray. There are many in the community, unfortunately. You know, it's sad to see that there are some who don't pray. They couldn't care less. Or they say, well, I'm not convinced about God yet, so I'm not going to pray. It would be wiser to take the secured method and say, I'm not certain, but that doesn't mean I will abandon my duty, which tomorrow, should I find out to be the real duty, I will have to repay, which may be a bigger burden for me. Allah says, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَلَذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ. I will speak about salah. And what does Karbala represent about salah? Salah is at the core of Karbala. Imam Hussein was on the battlefield for the sake of salah. That is why he was there. A Muslim who has profession, who professes tawheed and acceptance to the messenger, if he or she does not pray, is condemning himself. Allah mentions in the Quran that the inmates of hell shall be the ones who did not pray, because they gave allegiance to Allah, but they refused to submit to Allah. And they think that because they were praying, they were doing Allah a favor. What Allah says, nay, that prayer was good for you. تَنْحَ عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. It prevents you from wrongdoing and evil. And Allah is so merciful that He has broken up these prayers into 5 daily prayers from the morning to the evening time, such that your whole day is divided in such a way that prayer always comes in between your life, forcing you to reconsider your position. While you're in the middle of the business transactions in the afternoon, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forces you to stop and reconsider your position and go to your Lord, take your shoes off, go and do your wudu, freshen up, go and do your sujood. You know, all of these thoughts stop you dead in your tracks. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants me to reconsider my position. He says, go after that. You see? وَإِذَا قُضِيَتِ الصَّلَاةُ فَانْتَشِرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَابْتَغُوا مِنْ فَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَاذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. When it is finished, this Jum'ah prayer, disperse, go and do your business, go. But give some time. People have no 5 minutes even. They don't even have 5 minutes to give to Allah. They make 5,000 excuses to avoid a 5-minute duty. We will speak about that, inshallah. But that is the obligation that we were talking about. So a person who understands Qiyamah and knows that his obligations are accounted for, that every word he or she says has been written, and that if I am evil to you, I'm going to be held liable for it, and my Lord is going to punish me for it, you have a lot of fear. You become an excellent human being. A human being you love to have in your house, in your friendship, in your business. It becomes a great asset for you. Haven't you seen? There are those kinds of friends who are such a mercy that the days you're in a bad mood, you just have to look at them and you feel good about it. To have those kinds of people is not easy. To have the very substance of a human being who's not just wishy-washy Mr. Good. No, he is firmly grounded in goodness, where if the breeze or the wind blows like a hurricane, he's firm, nothing uproots him. Quran gives so many kinds of analogies to this, that this true believer is the one whose roots are deep, who understands. What is deep is the one who understands in Tawheed and has clear understanding of Yawmul Qiyamah. This puts us in full phase now, where all these distractions into this world, you just see them as tools by which to reach your Akhirah. This belief in Akhirah and Yawmul Qiyamah is the fundamental principle in Islam, my brothers and sisters. That I'll give you the best example, and I've used it before, and inshallah I'll move on. Imagine I go into business with you, and we don't have any agreements, or we do have agreements, and let's say every once in a while I get a little extra paychecks, and I just keep pocketing it. Astaghfirullah. I keep taking it, you know, loose transactions. As long as I don't feel I'm going to be held accountable for it, I couldn't care less, you know. A little slip here, a little slip there, who cares? I mean, you know, I can justify myself to take a little extra money from you. People do that all the time. The thievery, as I mentioned yesterday, the wretchedness of crooks that we have in our society is rampant. Rampant. The reason it is rampant is such people have no belief in Yawmul Qiyamah. They could not care less. As a result, they steal from each other, clearly. What you find is, what if you received a letter from the judge saying that this business transaction is under investigation, and now we would like you to come in front of the judge with a subpoena, and you're going to come and present your case because we are accusing you of possible theft and embezzlement. Suddenly you find yourself your entire attitude changes in that transaction, isn't it? You suddenly become cognizant of every transaction. You try to reflect on all those moments when you stole the money, if you did, and you try to find every possible argument by which you can use in front of the judge to escape that treachery. The difference is the judge is not all-knowing and all-seeing. And the difference is that the judge has to find the evidence in front of you to catch you. But on the day of judgment, my tongue, my hands, my skin, my bones, my eyes shall speak against me according to the Holy Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, your entire body shall bear witness to who you were on this earth. The tongue will speak to Allah and say to Allah, I abused people. I spoke against people. I was wicked against people. And there is nothing you can do to hide it. It will speak by itself. No need to present any receipts. No need to present any backlog books. It's all charted right in front of you. Clear as day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذَا وَقَعَتِ الْوَاقِعَ لَيْسَ لِوَقَعَتِهَا كَاذِبَ خَافِذَةٌ رَافِعَ إِذَا رُجَّتِ الْأَرْضُ رَجَّا وَبُسَّتِ الْجِبَالُ بَسًّا فَكَانَتْ هَبَاءً مُنْبَثًا. Allah says that day, the great event, the day of judgment, He says, أَزْوَاجًا ثَلَاثَ, three groups shall be formed. The people of the left and the people of the right, and وَالسَّابِقُونَ السَّابِقُونَ, the nearest of the near, these will be divided and their judgment will be held. When a human being believes in that, he becomes a different being. I would love to express more, but my time is up on this issue. Well, I'd just like to say, my brothers and sisters, that the expression of us thinking about this is you find that such people who are caught in the court of law change their attitude because there is a police system. The belief in Yawm al-Qiyamah, the day of judgment, is fundamental to making the human being complete. My brothers and sisters, all of us should go home and reflect of that day of judgment where my son, my father, my brother, my sister, nobody will help me. I will be saying, nafsi, nafsi, nafsi. Me, I want to know, where am I going? Where is my destiny? If you and I plan our lives today and prepare ourselves, we are going to die anyway. We're going to grow old anyway, guaranteed. No plastic surgeon will keep our skin from sagging. There comes a point where you can just stretch the skin so far. Then what? Then you have to die. As a matter of fact, if you live more than 100 years of age, you are a burden to your family and to your society. Where I've seen people who are 120, the families are saying, or the friends are saying, when is this old man going to kick the bucket and go? He's just a burden to me. I said, Astaghfirullah, how do you say it? He says, well, this guy, we've done ghusl to him, we think he's dead. Every time we put him in the thing, we take him, he suddenly wakes up. We can't get rid of him. It's very sad when you think about it, that human being who's behind that body, sure, the body is old and it's breaking apart, but the soul in him is as the same child as what that he was born. That old man does not feel old inside. Oh no, he's as young as a young child. Just his body is preventing him from being that flexible child he was. But he's wiser, all right. He's seen a lot more than that infant child. Oh, sure. And he can make a lot less mistakes than that infant child. But he is trapped in this body. And how sad it is that as much as you give to society, the world is waiting for you to leave. It is sad. It is sad when you see an old man entering a congregation where no one even looks at him because he is not important. It's the young, beautiful child that's important for everybody to look at because that's what's marketable. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to see this. He says, look at you, you're going to go. Your days are numbered. The day you were born, the day of your death was already marked. Your return ticket was made. Prepare yourselves. Why do you cheat yourselves? Our messenger has said, have you seen anybody build a house on a bridge? Have you seen anybody build a house on a bridge? And the companion says, no. He says, this life is a bridge. You are crossing from one life to another. Don't waste your time building your homes on a bridge. Go and build it on firm ground, which is akhirah. Allah says, بَلْ تُؤْثِرُونَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. Nay, you love this world, but the akhirah is better for you. It is more, it's better, and it is forever. Salawat Allah Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. I was going to speak today about Surah Hujurat, because Surah Hujurat, Surah number 49, is a surah which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the theme is consistent with regards to akhlaq, Akhlaq meaning ethics, how we should behave. Who are we as human beings? What does it mean, brotherhood? Who is an enemy in Islam? Who is a hypocrite, etc., etc.? All these aspects are mentioned in the Surah Hujurat. Those of us who have the time, and my brothers and sisters, let us not make excuses about the Quran. Quran is a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a gem that even the angels in the sky, when they hear humans reciting Quran, they say they are elated, they are delighted, because the kalam of Allah is being recited. Allah is so merciful to us that He says to us, if you just open the Quran, just look at the Quran, you will receive mercy. Just open it up and you will receive mercy. Read it, you will receive mercy. Memorize it, you will receive even greater mercy. Put it in action with understanding and you will receive enormous mercy. Allah says, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَلَا يَزِيدُ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا خَسَارًا. What we have revealed in this Quran is a shifa, is an intercessor for the believers, and it increases nothing for the disbeliever but destruction. So we, those who profess the deen of Islam and this great book, the Quran, which our messenger meticulously made sure that before his lifetime ended, that he compiled it, put it together, and presented it to mankind. That when he said, Inni tarikun fikum al-thaqalain, Kitabullahi, Kitabullahi, the kitab was done, Kitabullahi wa itrati ahl bayti, that I leave you to you two heavy things, the kitab of Allah and your obedience in itrat. Itrat Ahl al-Bayt, meaning my Ahl al-Bayt, which this universe was created for, and the Prophet being at the center of this Ahl al-Bayt, he says, I leave you these two things. Don't disconnect yourselves from these two, because you cannot. If you do, you will lose. And these two will never be separated until they meet me on the day of Kawthar, in the pool of Kawthar. So let us read the Quran. When we read Surah Hujurat, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, la tuqaddimu bayna yaday Allahi wa rasuli. Wattaqullah. Don't go ahead of the messenger, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His messenger. Have fear of Allah. You see? These are beautiful verses. If you read one after the other, given the time, my next time, inshallah, tomorrow, I will do a brief introduction of Surah Hujurat, the tafsir done by Ayatollah Jafar Subhani, which he has written a recent book called The Islamic Moral System. How does the moral system of Islam equate with the rest of the ethical systems in the world? You'll find it's a brilliant presentation from Surah Hujurat. Just this one surah, take a little time, all of us, understand it. When I was young, I remember when I read this, just one ayah, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, la yaskhar qawmun min qawmin asa an yakunu khayran minhum. ولا نساء من نساء عسى ان يكن خيرا منهن ولا تلمزوا انفسكم ولا تنابزوا بالالقاب بئس الاسم الفسوق بعد الايمان ومن لم يتوب فاولئك هم الظالمون. I started to cry. I said, this is the verse I want to absorb. What does it say? Oh, you believe. Don't laugh at each other. Perchance you're better than the other. And you women, don't laugh at each other. Perchance you're better than the other. And don't give yourselves bad names and don't find faults with each other. What a beautiful social relationship Allah says. Oh, you who believe, this is your duty. And I look at that, I said, oh Allah, give me the strength to be a follower in this ayah, that I should never make fun of people. Sure, we slip sometimes when we make statements that may sound like we're making fun, but it is never the intention to make fun of anyone, because in front of Allah, we are nothing. Look at everybody with humbleness. لا يسخر قوم. Allah said, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَتُوبْ. And if you do not ask for forgiveness, فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. Then you are an evildoer. This should vibrate in my soul daily. I wake up in the morning, someone's talking to me, this verse should come to the tip of my tongue. That when I'm talking to a person, don't laugh at him just because you think you may know more than he does. No, you're not allowed to do that. This is the beauty. Surah Hujurat continuously moves. إنما المؤمنون إخوة فأصلحوا بين. Subhanallah, imagine at Fajr time after Salah, you start reciting Surah Hujurat, with each verse coming into its meaning and it's standing in front of you, looking at you beautifully. Allahu Akbar. That is what we call starting a day, when the Quran becomes part of your life. Our messenger said, those who recite the Quran at Fajr time, they are like stars shining on the other side of the universe. That house is like a star shining on the other side of the universe. Some of us say we don't know how to read the Quran. Let us start somewhere. Start even with a short ayah, a short surah. And it's amazing, some of us who speak Arabic cannot even recite the Quran. There is no excuse for anybody, no matter what language you speak. The Quran is a language you and I must stand by, talk all the time.
Imam Hussein alayhisalam in Karbala, after his body was severed from his head, they put his head on a spear. They say miraculously, Imam Hussein alayhisalam was still reciting from Suratul Kahf. Our Imam was reciting, they could hear the voices from his tongue recitation. You might say, but his head has been severed from his blessed body. It doesn't matter. They are alive. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing the importance of our Imams who withstood and stood talking nothing but the Quran. They were the embodiment of the Quran in action. Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam says that to the people in Safin. When they put the Quran in spears, they said, you know, la hukma illa billah. They said, no judgment except the Quran. Imam says, those are written texts of Allah. I am the action of that text. You need to follow me. I am the one that the prophets left behind. Me, I am the example of that Quran. Me, An-Naba'il Azim. I am An-Naba'il Azim. You need to follow us. We are the examples of the Quran. We will tell you what that Quran means. We will describe every verse for you, why it was revealed the way it was revealed. It is we who have been endowed with that knowledge. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. So we take ourselves to Karbala. Imam Hussein alayhi wasalam is an example of Surah Hujurat. Complete. The one who is in total obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That the situation had gotten so bad that our Imam was trying his best to move away from this. He calls his close companions. He says to them, the situation has reached terrible states. It's a terrible moment. During this period of time, our Imam is meeting secretly with Umar ibn Sa'd, who is the commander-in-chief of the army in Karbala. And you find that Imam Hussein alayhi wasalam is trying to move away from this treachery. Is he afraid of Karbala? No. Is he hungry for power? No. It is not the sign of an Imam. What we find is our Imam wants to save the other side from damnation. That's his real mission. To save them from eternal hell. This is what our Imam is trying to do. For him to die, they have made a deal with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That this life has no meaning to us if it doesn't mean to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It has no meaning. It is useless, as the companions were saying. There were thousands of them with our Imam. Imam is meeting with Umar ibn Sa'd. Ibn Sa'd finally gets convinced that Imam Hussein is certainly a genuine man. He's a sincere man. So he sends a message to Kufa, and the letter is addressed to Ibn Ziyad, the governor, that Hussein ibn Ali alayhi wasalam has agreed not to bother us, so let us leave him alone. Ibn Ziyad, as wicked as he was, also became convinced of this fact, and he said, it's true, because Ibn Ziyad also was terrified of fighting Imam Hussein. This is an historical fact. Ibn Ziyad was terrified of fighting Imam Hussein. Terrified. Because he knew this is not an ordinary man you're going to be fighting. This is the representative of Allah you're going to fight. And there's going to be much destruction to come if we touch him. So he was also evasive, but his arrogance always came in the way. And Shaitan had his arch representative there. Was none other than Shimr Dhul-Jawshan. Shimr Dhul-Jawshan had no remorse, was a disbeliever in Allah at all, completely. Our Imam in fact addresses him. He says, you are the biggest hypocrite that has walked on this. You, in fact, Burair Hamadani says to him, he says, you walk on 70 letters. In Arabic it means that you are such a hypocrite that you have 70 faces. That's how you are. Shimr says to Ibn Ziyad, he says, how can you do this? How can you let this man slide? How can you let him escape? We've cornered him in Karbala. We've got to get him. What do you think Yazid is going to say if he comes to find out that you've let this man escape from your grips? And Ibn Ziyad realizes that is true. If I don't get him, I will fail my mission. And after all, my caliph who's supporting me will be very disappointed for me. I must fulfill his obligations because he got the command from Yazid that you've got to get the bay'ah from Hussein ibn Ali. So Shimr says to him, he says, this Ibn Sa'd is a coward. So Ibn Sa'd now is having a challenge with Shimr because Shimr actually wants to be the commander of the army in Karbala. He wants to be the leader. So he's trying to find a weak point in Ibn Sa'd so that he can use it towards the governor, so that the governor should give him the authority to lead the army, not Umar ibn Sa'd. So Ibn Ziyad writes a letter under the command of Shimrz al-Jawshan that get the bay'ah, meaning the signature of Hussein ibn Ali, or get his head, one or the other, no questions asked. So Shimr immediately gets on his horse with his small group of entourage, and they rush towards Karbala. And when they arrived on the 8th, I think the 9th night of Muharram. And the situation had gotten grave now. And when the letter comes, our Imam realizes that there's no escape now. And Ibn Sa'd, who had already agreed with Imam Hussein to let him go, suddenly shifts his angle. The reason is, if he doesn't shift, he's going to lose his position and the promise that has been made to him by the caliph. Thus, he feels on his own that he needs to fulfill the obligations of his master, otherwise he will be denied his reward. As a result, he goes one step further to prove to his caliph and to his governor that he is indeed capable of leading an army, that he's audacious enough to come forward on the day of Ashura in the morning and shouts to everybody, "O you in the world, watch! I, Umar ibn Sa'd bin Abi Waqqas, is the first man to start this battle." And he pulls the arrow and he aims towards the army of Imam Hussein and becomes the official man to start this battle. From the Sharia point of view, as I mentioned, no more grays, black and white. According to Islamic Sharia, in a battle of jihad, it is forbidden for the believer to start a battle. Forbidden, haram. Meaning if you start the battle against the enemy, you are the aggressor, not the defender. So what you find is Umar ibn Sa'd does that. And Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, when he hears this, the arrows start coming, and Imam is surprised, what's going on? He immediately sends Hazrat Abbas, his brother, with Imam Hussein, and they go towards the enemy. Imam enters the tent, and he's talking to Ibn Sa'd, and Ibn Sa'd says, there is no other way. Either you give bay'ah, or we kill you. And Hazrat Abbas is waiting outside patiently to get the news, and he comes back, and this news is told to the people, and now Imam gathers his companions and says, our situation has reached worst state we can be in. Now, it is destined that all our avenues to escape this has been shut from us. We're going to have to meet our destiny of martyrdom tomorrow morning. But Imam asks the army that give us one night to do dhikr of Allah. There's a beautiful story in this, that if somebody has asked you to give your allegiance or he will kill you, and your first thought is, if you're going to kill me, at least give me some time to remember my Lord, that's a very deep statement. These were some exclusive companions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who had such love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they were not worried about their death. Rather, they wanted to worship their Lord. They say on the night of Ashura, they were busy murmuring. You could hear like a buzzing sound. Everybody doing sujood and dhikr, and everybody was smiling in the camp of Imam Hussein. Who were these people? These were exclusive groups. Imam gathers them and says, our destiny has been sealed. Those of you who wish to leave, I forgive you. I relinquish my bay'ah on you, meaning your allegiance to me. I give it back to you. You're not obligated to stay with me. And he says, I will shut this light off, this little lamp in this tent, in the dark of the night. You leave, we won't even see who you are, so you don't feel embarrassed when you leave me. This is how the situation had reached. That while on the other side, they were parading and waiting to butcher this side, our Imam is showing his true characteristic as an Imam, that he is going to be massacred and his children are going to be massacred. But yet you find our Imam is very, very balanced. So he says to his companions, leave. And what you find is only a select 72 remain behind. 72, as I say, who were actual members who fought in these battles, meaning that they had experience in fighting. And there were about 25 or 30 who were walking across the desert. Some were crossing, and some of them saw this, and they joined. In particular, there was a personality by the name of Abdullah bin Umair Kalbi.
He is a unique story, my brothers and sisters. I will share with that and then I will conclude. You will find that this personality was with his wife in Kufa, and he loved Imam Hussein dearly. Abdullah bin Umair Kalbi was a passionate person who loved our Imams very much. But it's a love story. I want us to take a little lesson from a love story, because every example has been shown in Karbala. You find Abdullah ibn Umair had a wife by the name of Umm Wahab. These two loved each other dearly. You know, you see a couple, husband and wife, who have no vision of anyone in terms of their connectedness and love. It is between Abdullah ibn Umair Kalbi and his wife Umm Wahab. When she hears that Imam Hussein has been cornered in Karbala, she had this secret desire to become shaheed on the battlefield for the love of Imam Hussein also. A woman. Women are not allowed to go on the battlefield and fight. It is not in Islam. But her husband says, I will join the army of Imam Hussein. She convinces her husband that you take me with you also, because I also want to join this battle. Not to fight, but at least let me be present to watch you support the Imam of the time. These two loved each other, but they loved the Imam dearly. This is a lesson for us all. Many of us claim to love Imam Hussein, but really many times we love ourselves more. That when our Imam tells us to do something, we don't obey him, rather we obey what we want. A classic example is here, that two people love each other very much, they do not violate the laws of Islam, even on the battlefield. And what you find is our blessed Imam invites them, they reach Karbala, and Abdullah bin Umair Kalbi is fully ironclad, and he stands in front of our Imam, tall, very strong. He says to our Imam, allow me to go to the front lines and fight for you. He was one of the first persons to go besides Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi. And Abdullah bin Umair Kalbi goes forward and he presents himself and two slaves of Ibn Ziyad, Salim. There were two slaves that came forward who were challenging on the opposite side. And Abdullah bin Umair represents himself, says, I. And they said, tell us who you are. Usually that was the style. You address yourself and then you fight. And Abdullah bin Umair Kalbi comes and he presents himself and they say, we don't want you. We want Habib ibn Madahir. We want Zuhair ibn Qain to come forward and fight. We don't want you. And Abdullah bin Umair says, do you know who I am? I am that lion of the desert. Come and fight me first. So you find that as he's fighting, his wife is standing in the back and cheering him. Yes, Abdullah, go forward. How many women have the guts to have their husband stand on the battlefield when they know they will come back beheaded? And she is cheering him, go, go, become shaheed, subhanallah. You call that love? That is the ultimate love, where the wife loves her husband so much, she is willing to sacrifice him for the love of Allah. Allah says, لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ. You will never achieve righteousness until you love with that which you love. You give with that which you love most. Abdullah bin Umair Kalbi is fighting and his wife gets so excited about her husband fighting and saving and protecting her Imam that she gets overly excited. She leaves her tent and runs towards the battlefield cheering him. She loses control of herself. She comes in the middle of the battlefield and our Imam notices that. He says, oh Umm Wahab, come back. It is not for you to be on the battlefield. And while she has her eyes on her husband, because her passion is for her husband giving his life, fi sabilillah, she turns and looks at the Imam, and the Imam says, no. She says, the Imam is more important. She stops dead in her tracks, and she comes back reluctantly back to her tent, standing there agitated to see her husband fighting. During this period of time, Abdullah bin Umair turns towards his wife and is telling her, go back. That he tries to hold a blow and his fingers get cut off and his fingers fall off. And Abdullah bin Umair immediately turns around and comes back and dresses himself and prepares himself to go forward again. Abdullah bin Umair Kalbi was one of the first people who went forward and he fought so valiantly. They say he killed over 150 plus people. Finally, the enemies realize that if these people were to fight one-on-one, they will destroy the entire army of Umar ibn Sa'ad. So they decided to pelt them with stones, throw rocks at them, do every treacherous act upon them to try to subdue them, because these people were not ordinary people. Bear in mind, my brothers and sisters, this is on the day of Ashura, when these personalities have not had a drop of water in their mouth.
I tell you, when you go to that part of the world, when you don't even get a glass of water within a few hours, you start seeing mirages. How these people had such fervor to fight for Imam Hussein for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just baffles the human mind. To that extent that Abdullah bin Umair Kalbi goes forward again and again, this time on his horse, he is pulled off his horse, he is dragged. The wife is watching this. Allahu Akbar. How can you? How can someone who loves you so much stand there while you're being dragged? Blood is dripping everywhere. There's carnage everywhere in front of you. You know that your husband is going. He's breathing his last. And they say an enemy comes from the back and strikes him on his head, on Abdullah bin Umair, while he's on the floor. And he becomes shaheed immediately. He says, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Now she becomes so passionate about her husband's death that the enemies move back. That she goes towards her husband who's lying on the desert now. And she picks him up, puts his head on her lap, and she's caressing him. She says, my husband, you have gone. You have done a great deed. She's so happy. She's also wishing she could join him. Shimr Zuljoshan from the back sees this. He says, get rid of that woman. Get rid of that woman. And an enemy comes forward, and while she's busy caressing her husband, a man from the back strikes her on the head and kills her. And they say one more woman was taken on the battlefield that was so ruthlessly taken that she becomes shaheed with her husband. And Imam is watching this. He sees and he witnesses this relationship take place in the battlefield. Allahu Akbar. In continuation, my brothers, when all these members passed away, there was one personality who is the most important of all personalities after Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, and that was Abbas ibn Ali alayhi salatu wasalam. Who was Abbas? Abbas was a birth. Imam Ali planned his birth. After Bibi Fatima became shaheed, he says, I need a son who will represent my son on Karbala. And he did genealogical searches and found there's a woman by the name of Ummul Baneen, the mother of sons. And she comes from a strong lineage. Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam marries her and she gives birth to four sons. Four. And all these four sons, the leader of them was Abbas ibn Ali, the brother of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. That he was a tall, statured person, strong, powerful. And Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, before his death, he holds the hand of Hazrat Abbas and puts it in the hand of Imam Hussein. He says, I leave the two of you together. That there will come a day soon when he shall be cornered, this Imam of yours. Make sure you protect him. This was the planning. Abbas ibn Ali alayhi salatu wasalam was somebody we can talk for days about his love for Imam Hussein as his brother, but he always addressed his brother as my Imam. And Abbas ibn Ali alayhi salatu wasalam is ready now. All the companions have been killed. The family members have been killed. Everybody has been killed. The person left behind alone is Imam Hussein and Abbas standing on the front lines protecting his Imam. So Abbas comes to Imam Hussein and says, give me permission to go now. Imam says, before you go, the children are thirsty. They are crying. Make one more effort to go and get some water. Go to the Euphrates and get these children some water. So Abbas ibn Ali ascends on his horse and goes towards the Euphrates. And he breaks through the ranks and he reaches the Euphrates and fills the mishk, what they call this water bag, with water. And he fills it. He's so thirsty that water is right in front of him. 3 days he has not had a sip of it. But he says, I can't have this if my master has not touched it.